Okay, so hello everyone. I'm Eldad and I'm leading the Germany Clouds community. 1 year ago, me and my friends decided to establish a new cloud experts community. And after 1 year, we are proud to say that we are in the right way and our community is fastly growing. We are now over than 1,000 members. Our main goal is to evolve the cloud adoption in Germany by gathering experts from the different cloud domains to contribute their knowledge to other people and to have an active community that produces content and knowledge. Today, we are happy to host a meetup that focuses on cloud security, the need of rapidly adopt cloud-based solutions in order to support the business goals of the company, bring cybersecurity risks that must be considered in a risk-based approach. On our agenda today, we are happy to bring two super interesting topics, starting at five. It's five and a few minutes. Dirk Herrmann is the manager of the engineering for Palo Alto Networks. And he will speak about how to embed security into your pipeline. The second speaker for today would be Peter Van Eyck, and he will present the topic of how to gain control by letting go. Two super interesting topics, and I recommend to you to ask questions and to be an active participant for this presentation. Many thanks to Palo Alto Networks for the extensive cooperation and the support in our Germany Clouds community. And before I'm handing over to the first speaker, we would like and we would happy to, if you'll join to our group on LinkedIn, Germany Clouds in one word. Thank you all for joining us, and I will hand over to the first speaker. Thank you very much.
Many thanks. You should be able to see the screen now. Many thanks for the introduction and the kind words. So basically, once we've been asked to present about cloud and cloud security, we decided to pick one special topic because simply assuming that the overall and very broad topic of cloud and cloud native security is too broad to be covered in 30 minutes. And it's kind of commodity in the meantime. So many customers and people do understand what's needed in order to secure the overall public cloud footprint or to secure the workloads running on top of it. But still, we feel that many customers are more struggling on how to avoid all the alerts which then happen in the production environment in your public cloud. And that's why we decided to focus on this particular topic here. So how can I prevent that security incidents are happening in my production environment to some extent at least? And this requires that we bring in all the security aspects very early into the software development lifecycle. And in this particular webinar, I would like to summarize a little bit the key findings from our point of view, what's needed and what should be done in early stages of the software development in order to prevent those misconfigurations and corresponding security alerts. And basically, it's based on a lot of experience. We're working with dozens of customers across EMEA and also across the globe, obviously, on implementing a little bit more than just the plain security aspects, so more than just the traditional cloud security posture management or cloud workload protection. But especially, we are focusing on helping developer organizations to be more efficient in the area of security. And let me start with a high-level introduction of what we believe really matters. So if you look at the DevOps principles, and if you try to compare them with traditional, let's say, methods or paradigms from traditional security teams, obviously it's not a good fit. However, it's fairly easy to apply effectively the same principles which basically define DevOps as a whole, also for the IT security, you just need to change the perspective a little bit. But if you just look at the different key aspects, such as collaboration, and then basically the key finding here is the application security design is not just a security team owned item, it's a collaborative effort similar to application development, where the different teams are collaborating with each other, share expertise, and then work together on making the best out of it. And also the same principles apply to shift left, right? So shift left, the testing and everything else. And this also applies to security, because it's a little bit more than just shifting left the security tool. So it's not about throwing a particular security tool over the fence to the developer. It's really about shift left also the expertise, the collaboration, the findings, and the remediation, especially, again, in order to avoid that incidents are happening in the production environment. And one of the key aspects, and this is what we will double click in this webinar a little bit further, is really automation, right? So if you cannot automate the whole flow in the same way as you do for your traditional application and application testing, then you will fail, right? So it's the goal should be that all the different security aspects and capabilities are automated as much as possible, because this significantly increases the overall productivity, right? It's really all about not just getting results out of it, such as scan results or finding. It's really kind of providing reliable and also actionable insights, which really helps the corresponding owners of the finding to prioritize and then to remediate accordingly. And it's kind of obvious that this also requires that you monitor all the assets, both the known and also the unknown, so the newly deployed asset. And especially the focus for us is on the unforeseeable behavior, especially topics like runtime defense or network malicious IP address access and stuff like this. And this comes along typically leveraging with modern technologies such as artificial intelligence, because this is not what a human being can easily do. And this is also something the software can do more, way more efficiently. And then there's one other important aspect here. It's also about adding more and further line of defense to all the different aspects, but I will double click into this into a second. So if I just look back on all the majority of projects when we initially started to talk to customers, basically many customers, they primarily did three major things in the security space. They applied some kind of security best practices to the software development side, and they did some kind of image scanning, and they added some kind of firewall at the ingress point of the environment. And most of those customers somewhat believe that this is sufficient and this is at least a starting point. We don't disagree on the starting point, but we tend to disagree on that it's not sufficient. But the main reason why the customers haven't done more than what we showed on the previous slide is primarily because they struggled to automate the security testing as they do for all the other testing. So if you look at reports such as the Accelerate State of the DevOps report, then you might notice the majority of IT organizations in the meantime are doing a great job on automating the builds and the tests and the deployments. So all the new technologies are helping with those, but they are still struggling with automating specifically the security testing. And this is probably aligned to what I call the mirror challenge. So there are two different challenges customers are facing, and I will explain them in the next few minutes a little bit in further detail. So if we try to break the software lifecycle into different stages or lifecycle phases, then let's start with the design phase. So before somebody starts to develop code or any kind of software or configuration, the design phase is probably the most critical phase. And it's also the phase many customers are not very much focusing on, especially on the security side, right? But the challenge here in this particular phase is the 100:10:1 ratio, which typically means 100 developers are meeting 10 ops guys and one security person. And that's why it's even more important that the security team is involved in very early stages of the software development lifecycle in order to bring in the expertise, looking at it from a security point of view, being involved in architectural decisions, and decisions where from the very beginning, separate building blocks or technologies decision are made. And if needed, they can at least influence or share their own view on what's possible to secure those different types of architectures. And especially the responsibility of the security team in this particular phase is really to explain what are the capabilities of the security platform or the tooling which is currently used and how this could be integrated into the architecture and also into the corresponding workflows. So it's really about shifting left the expertise and not just the tool. So the tooling decision is a secondary aspect, but it's really being involved very early and also to discuss the security aspects of an application really as part of the application architecture design. And it's supposed to be the as declarative as the software itself or the new software stack. So we are talking about a policy as code as a best state of the art, right? And another very important aspect in the design phase is to have a clear understanding of who owns what, right? And this includes who's writing policies, who's approving those, and who's also getting alerted and who owns the remediation. Because what typically happens is that somebody is using a security tool which fires a huge amount of alerts, and then it's not really clear who is supposed to remediate all those incidents which then are created in one of the tools such as ServiceNow or Jira or something similar, right? So this needs to be defined very early in the software development stage, that everybody has a clear understanding of what's needed. And then once we start developing the software, and software again, software is not just the plain source code anymore. Software also includes all the configuration. And in modern application architectures, this also includes the automated deployment, which makes the infrastructure as a code template probably the most critical ones also from a security perspective, because security vulnerabilities or finding vulnerabilities in binaries or container images, that's fairly easy, but it's a little bit more tricky if you look at the impact and associated risk of using a misconfigured Terraform template, for example. And this is what I call the 1 to 10 to 100 challenge, because one misconfiguration in a template, which is used 10 times, is firing at least 100, typically more than 1,000 alerts in a production environment. So the earlier you can find those misconfigurations in those infrastructure as a code templates, the better you can prevent that all those security incidents are happening in production. And this applies not only to Terraform, this obviously also applies to Docker files supposed to be used to build the initial Docker image, to Helm charts, Kubernetes YAML files, everything else you are using in order to define or specify an application or the application architecture, and then what you are using as a template. And the recommendation here is the security tooling should be able to be integrated already in the developer toolchain in the earlier stage, which means in the IDE. So within the IDE, so before you even saved a particular template, you can see misconfigurations, you are getting notified, you are getting some guidance on what you should do differently or better in order to avoid this particular security risk. And then as the next step, before or while you are checking this in into Git, for example, then you are getting notified as a pre-commit check, hey, this is a kind of a misconfiguration. Are you sure that you really want to submit this PR? And if not, we also can implement some kind of additional security or approval checks that somebody else needs to approve the PR. And this could involve somebody from the security team who then can make the decision whether the security findings which have been called out as part of the PR are something he would like to approve or not. And another important aspect here is that while you're starting to do the software development and defining all the different templates, it's also important to think about how can we automate the whole policy management, which is the additional aspect of an application. And this means writing and configuring the policies as code, and also the writing of the test cases, which are used then in the next stage of the CI/CD pipeline, where not only the application and the application behavior, but also the security aspects are supposed to be tested in a fully automated manner. And it's also important to leverage whatever the security platform provides, such as custom compliance checks. So not all of the out-of-the-box compliance frameworks which exist out there 100% match to the specific customer requirements. So leverage the capability of defining your own compliance checks in order to assess, manage, measure, and also to enforce your own security baselines, which could be slightly different from some of the most well-known industry frameworks. And then during the test, and we did a bunch of different webinars just in the past few months, where we demonstrated this in a very powerful demo, where we basically brought all the different shift left capabilities the security platform offers into a single pipeline, just to demonstrate how easy it is to fully automate the end-to-end testing of an application. And we explicitly mean here a little bit more than just the plain scanning or container image scanning many customers are doing. So it's really about bringing together the different capabilities we have. It starts with the dependency checking within the Git repository, where we already, before we even built the binary and then the container image out of it, we can verify whether there are vulnerabilities defined as a dependency. And we can already break the pipeline at this point, because it doesn't make sense that we build the binary, build the image, start to deploy it, verify it, if we already know earlier that we will never go to deploy this particular image because it contains vulnerabilities which do not meet our requirements. And the same applies to security policy as code, right? So if we define this as a mandatory additional asset, which needs to be provided similar to the image and the application specification itself, we can verify whether they exist, whether they can be uploaded to the security platform, whether the configuration works. And then we can test the functionality of this policy as code in later stages of the pipeline and in fully automated fashion. Of course, we do image scanning. Of course, we scan the infrastructure as a code template, as I mentioned earlier, whether it's the Terraform template, the Kubernetes YAML or Helm chart or whatever else you're using, as an additional check. So before you're going to deploy it, we can verify them. And if they contain some critical misconfigurations, then of course we can stop the pipeline already there. And then of course we will deploy the particular image or the application. We can verify the runtime behavior using the runtime defense capabilities of the security platform. But we can also, for example, verify in this particular demo use case, we picked the web application firewall we also used to demonstrate the power of policy as code, where we basically defined a simple web application firewall rule set as part of policy as a code. We uploaded it to the platform, and then we verified it in the pipeline, right? And what this means is you can bring together all those different aspects in the pipeline and in fully automated fashion. And this is really required in order to be really aligned to modern software development principles, where this fully automated pipeline is a crucial aspect of it. I want to call out a few things which really matters in this particular context, because many customers also and other guys are struggling with the simple distinction between, yeah, vulnerability scanning is fine, but it's not sufficient. Vulnerabilities is one aspect, but probably even more important is malware. If you're talking about malware, and especially look at the most recent malware attacks which happened in the industry, then you might notice malware scanning is a little bit more than just comparing some hash sums. So our very powerful malware service called Whitefire, for example, it picks the suspect file, it uploads it, it can do a multi-step forensic analysis of it. It runs on a bare metal system, so the malware doesn't know it's running in a sandbox environment and doesn't prevent the typical behavior and stuff it is. And then the findings are reported back within seconds or within minutes, which really helps you to identify this another critical aspect, which goes beyond just the traditional vulnerability scanning. And from an overall tracking or success measurement point of view, the amount of security issues and especially the time to remediate during the software development is a very crucial success criteria to measure the overall success of a DevSecOps approach within the software development lifecycle. And this is fairly easy to do if you are able to fire corresponding alerts directly in the bug tracking system such as Jira and then measure the time to remediate in an automated fashion. One other important aspect, and I've been in many webinars in my previous life, where Dan Walsh, one of the key thought leaders behind SE Linux, basically all the time reminded the guys, if SE Linux is preventing that an application is running, the worst thing you can do is disabling it. And of course, this applies to all the security capabilities. So if the application isn't running, obviously because it's blocked by some of the security tuning, so instead of switching it off, you should use the forensic data analyzers instead instead, in order to troubleshoot and then try to figure out whether you need to change something on the application or something on the security tooling configuration, such as whitelisting. And there's another important aspect, because it's both the developer perspective, but also the security team perspective. So both should be able to verify the different aspects, the different findings during the pipeline side by side, because you also need to keep in mind, while a particular development team is primarily focusing on one particular application or one particular pipeline run, the security team effectively needs to oversee all the different pipelines and applications which are used and built in the customer environment. And of course, if you cannot automate every single thing, then of course it might make sense that you at least start the manual security testing in parallel. From a vulnerability perspective, I want to call out that it's a little bit more than just the point of time scaling. So I saw, or I worked with many customers who just did this initial vulnerability point of time scanning during the pipeline. It hasn't found the vulnerability. The image has been fairly new, used latest, greatest, and then they started to deploy it. And not everybody is deploying new application versions every single day. And then the container is running for many weeks or even months. And then the guys are very surprised that in the meantime, vulnerabilities are coming out. They can occur at any time. And of course, the vulnerability, the threat vectors are changing over time, right? So this is very important. And another important, even more important aspect is a vulnerability is just one finding, but it's not really helpful if you don't consider this particular context, because it really makes a difference whether an image just contains an important vulnerability, but is not used or not exposed, compared with an image which also contains the same vulnerability, but runs as a privileged container, is exposed to the internet, and then gets accessed from malicious IPs somewhere from the outside. This, of course, is changing the whole risk perspective. And then tools like the risk score or the automated risk scoring tree can help you not only to define what is the highest risk, also help you to define to prioritize the corresponding mitigation, because not every single development team is able to mitigate nearly every security tool finding, right? So that's why it's important that you can prioritize. And if you prioritize, then of course you also need to be able to whitelist particular exceptions and also to whitelist specific content which is allowed to or proved to be used, so trusted content and the corresponding configuration. It's also important that not only an alert is fired in the sense of somebody is getting an email, hey, there's something going on. It's also important that there is a little bit more information, so detailed forensics, which really helps you to do an in-depth analysis of what exactly happens. Because if you look at the most common threats and attacks, then it's not that easy to really figure out what exactly is causing it, what's coming from, and what else is impacted by this particular security breach. And it's, of course, it's very obvious, in my opinion, that security needs to cover more than just the application, right? So it starts with the underlying cloud infrastructure, goes over the orchestrator, all the corresponding configuration, then of course the workloads running on top of it, including all the surrounding aspects such as the network connections, but also the data backends, right? So we introduced this data security module specifically to look into the S3 bucket to identify social security numbers, credit card numbers and stuff like this, because this is something which is typically ignored while everybody's just looking at the application itself and the container images and the application specification, which forms the particular image. In the next one, it's very important. You can test and verify a huge amount of things during the pipeline. However, there are still also a huge amount of things you cannot detect during the pipeline. And as I mentioned earlier, for example, many of the modern malwares typically, they don't appear immediately, which means if you deploy a container or instantiate a pod, it's not that automatically, immediately the malware is starting to do something. It sometimes takes hours or weeks or even longer until the malicious activities are starting. And then it's very important that you have a tooling which not only automatically models the expected application behavior and then fires alerts, which then are notifying somebody that, hey, this application is defined as a Postgres database container. So all the time, only the Postgres process has been running, but now somebody run a command called nmap in this container. This is an unexpected behavior. And this is worth to get an alert that something is probably going wrong. So this is the runtime defense, with an automated learning, which defines the expected behavior and then fires alert. But also this includes the additional malware scanning as part of the runtime, because we all know that not always the runtime is fully included or baked into an application. It's just the first step, such as the loader file or something, which then downloads the very specific file, which then are causing the corresponding threats. And it's also important that you can integrate the security tool into other third-party tools. And of course, some things are obvious, such as the messaging, Slack, whatever, the ticketing tools such as Jira, ServiceNow. But it's also important for further security investigation that you can integrate it into other tools, such as the SOAR tools, for example, Cortex SOAR or Splunk Phantom, to do some further investigation and further remediation, looking at it from a SOC team perspective. And another very important aspect is that the tooling supports some kind of auto remediation, which really helps you to enforce baselines at scale, because you can detect a lot of misconfigurations and then you can click a couple of times or run a command in order to remediate. But it's of course way more powerful if you can medically prevent that those configurations are even deployed, which means you can switch on the auto remediation. And then each time this misconfigured asset is deployed in the misconfigured way, the remediation automatically changes it. And if this happens already during the testing stage, then of course you will detect it, whether it breaks the application or not. So there are plenty of different ways to solve those things very early in this in the life cycle. However, there are security findings which happen in your production environment, which you can't prevent because it's not foreseeable. And then it's very important that, of course, securing the production environment is still important. It's not that you get rid of all the security hardening requirements in your prod environment just because you are testing many different aspects in earlier stages of the lifecycle. And this is especially important if you look at the typical, let's say, behavioral pattern of a cloud infrastructure, right? So you start with a small environment, you have a few hosts, you have a Kubernetes cluster and a couple of pods. But of course, this is growing all the time, right? So it's important that, for example, new hosts, which are spin up in the cloud environment, are automatically not only detected, but also protected, in the sense of if there is a new host detected, then you can define that automatically the corresponding security agents are getting deployed in order to ensure that this host and all the workloads running on top of it can be automatically secured, and then it's part of the overall broad security view as well. And of course, the same applies to network. Network activities is a very complex thing. And of course, if you have something which really helps you to query different views from a security or from a network perspective on who is getting access to which particular thing, and then you can, for example, use capabilities such as identity-based micro-segmentation, not based on IP addresses anymore, but instead of being based on identities, in order to segment different applications from each other or different environments from each other. Of course, this really helps you even further. And then stuff like web application firewalls. So I do remember in the past, I haven't touched web application firewalls for many years because all the time, this has been far outside of the environment. So I've been working with containers and Kubernetes, but I never really touched the web application firewalls because it's mostly has been used to protect the ingress point. But if you have a cloud native web application firewall, which really sits directly within the Kubernetes environment, then of course this helps you to not only secure the ingress point, but also secure the east-west traffic between the different pods and applications. And if this web application firewall then helps you to protect your application against the OWASP top 10 attacks or SQL injections and stuff like this, this is of course even more powerful. And if you have the capability, then you should also consider to use it, right? And it's very important to call out that securing the application landscape, this is never a one-time effort, right? So this is really, it has to be based on continuous improvement. It's not something you do once and then you are done forever. You need to always improve based on all the findings, especially in the production environment. You will notice, oh, okay, this is something I haven't considered. I haven't been aware of this one. There are new capabilities coming out, typically on both the attacker website, the attacker side, but also on the security platform side. Start to investigate, okay, what are those new things and how can I leverage them to become even more productive and efficient in my security team and principles. So if I just try to summarize what I just very briefly talked about, and again, we did a very powerful webinar, which demonstrates all those capabilities in an end-to-end pipeline. It's still available somewhere online. You probably can search for it. And if you're interested to get another run of this webinar, just reach out and ping me somewhere here over the community or via LinkedIn, and we can notify you once we are running it again. So the key takeaway of this session is, identify all the different threats as early as possible, right? So do not wait until something is deployed or at least built, even built. Try to detect it really in very early stages, such as the IDE, at every Git commit, and especially during every pipeline run. So please ensure that all the security aspects and hardening is already applied during the pipeline testing, because otherwise you are testing an application behavior which doesn't match with the production environment, if, for example, the production environment has some further protection or hardening. So that's why I'm not a big fan of saying in your prod environment, everything is really locked down, but your dev environment is totally open. You can do whatever you want. That's not a good match, because it effectively prevents you to detect those things, but especially it prevents you to detect whether the security team at tooling eventually blocks the application or prevents that the application runs as expected. It's also very important to really review all the different security aspects and bring them very early into the application design phase, right? Really, the security team is supposed to help to describe what are the capabilities we have, what is the tooling we can leverage, what are the different methods or hardening paradigms we can apply to this particular application type or this particular architecture. What are the things we really need to double click on that? What are the things we really need to focus on? And especially also defining what is mandatory versus nice to have. Who owns what? Defining clear responsibilities. And of course, again, this only works if you are able to automate everything. So automating the security configuration, but also the testing and especially the deployment of the security configuration exactly the same way as you do for applications, right? So if you can fully automate it, build a test and deploy your application, why can't you do the same for the security aspects? There is no fundamental difference. It's just a matter of which tooling you're choosing, which then of course needs to have the capabilities in order to automate everything. And then again, it's very important, given the size of typical security or SOC teams, that you prevent that the security findings are really just only coming up in the production environment, right? So it's very important to find them as early as possible, because the required amount of efforts and costs in later stages of the software development lifecycle are significantly increasing, right? So that's why it's important to scan all those templates already during the development in order to prevent that these are even used and then finally triggering a lot of alerts. And it's also important to prioritize those things, to define responsibilities and the ownerships, which is sometimes really tricky if you just look at, for example, at the pipeline stage. Who is supposed to remediate something? Is it really the security team? Is it the ops team? Typically, the answer is both. And this brings me also to the collaboration aspect back. It's not a single ownership typically. Somebody, we just need to define one owner who really owns the ultimate decision. And this also includes thresholds and exceptions, right? Whitelisting, break glass deployment, emergency changes, all those different things. So it needs to be clear who is allowed to do those things and who is allowed to approve those things. And again, so the goal, of course, should be that also emergency changes can be automated exactly the same way as all the other deployments you're doing. Also, worth to call out that is still we heavily rely on humans, right? So we still need people who have the expertise and we need to involve them. But for some of the aspects, if there is a service available where software can help you, especially artificial intelligence can help you to detect something which is really hard or up to impossible to detect, then of course you should leverage this. And this especially applies to the unknown threats, which are typically harder to detect than just the plain vulnerability or misconfiguration in a particular template. So let me pause here to give you the opportunity to ask me any kind of questions, if there are any. I'm still here. me check. Hello? Oh, okay. I see that you hear me. I don't see questions in the chat. If there aren't any questions, I would be happy to just give you one outlook for policy as a code. If, oh yeah, there's a question. Go ahead, ask me. I'm not sure whether you can unmute or whether you need to put it on the chat. Yes, please ask the question in the chat if you cannot unmute yourself. I assume it's, you need to ask in the chat. Okay, the question is whether this is a single tool which performs all the stuff you can say. Yeah, the luckily the answer is yes. The single tool is called Prisma Cloud. It's the cloud native security platform powered by Palo Alto. And effectively, it's the combination out of a couple of acquisitions Palo Alto made in the past 2.5 years. So it started with RedLock and Evident.io. Later, we added Twistlock and PureSec, and then Operator for microsegmentation. And then Palo Alto developed a couple of additional modules. And this is not even the full scope of the platform. This is just the scope of the different shift left capabilities, mostly coming out of Prisma Cloud. In the meantime, enhanced by a most recent acquisition of a company called BridgeCrew. You might have heard about Chekhov as an open source tool, which we already integrated into this pipeline view because, for example, the infrastructure as a code scanning of BridgeCrew or Chekhov goes beyond the traditional infrastructure as a code scanning we already had in the platform. But yes, this is effectively a single platform show. And what we are doing in this pipeline is not a rocket science. We are just bringing together the different pieces the platform offers. So we have a bunch of out-of-the-box integration into the different pipeline tools. We are using Jenkins here in this picture, but of course the same applies to CircleCI, GitHub Actions, whatever else you are using. We are using the CLI commands. We are using the CI/CD tool integrations, the IDE integrations. We are using the API and a little bit very lightweight scripting just to demonstrate the power of the platform. But effectively, it's a single tool. Yeah, correct. Has this answered your question? You're welcome. Do I still have a minute or not? Question to the audience.
I just want to go ahead. Yes, please go ahead.
Okay. Then let me just give you one step beyond. So again, we did this demo and we talked about the pipeline automation, but effectively this is just the first step and there's even more than this one, right? So if you just look at the very broad topic of policy management and then from an automation point of view, what does policy as code means? Right, so the platform is very powerful. One of the area I haven't even touched in this presentation is the whole topic of really cloud security, right? So cloud security posture management. But if you look at the powerful capabilities the platform offers, I already mentioned that we can automatically detect all the new and existing assets and also new and existing assets. We immediately start the audit trail and we can apply all the out of the box policies. And we can also detect violations and default compliance standards and remediation guidance from day zero. So effectively, at the moment you are starting to deploy the platform, you already have a lot of information and you already start to some extent to get the information which is required to go to the next level to start remediating it. Of course, you can remediate within the platform, but as I explained earlier, you can also in parallel start remediate very early using the IDE integration, the Git commit integration during the pipeline. So you have many different ways to prevent or to remediate already before it's getting deployed. And then you can start to customize the whole thing, right? So then you implement kind of a GitOps-like approach for both the application and the security assets. I demonstrated the different capabilities in the pipeline, but obviously GitOps is a slightly different approach, but it's not fundamentally different. It's just a different way how to store and then do the handover to production. I talked about the fully automated pipeline testing. I mentioned the custom compliance checks. You can also reuse different other policy frameworks, such as OPA, the Open Policy Agents, and then leverage those capabilities capabilities within the platform. And then you can start to enter the next level where you really deeply integrate this into a further or advanced remediation tools such as Codex SOAR, or you integrate it into different other tools such as the CM tool or the cloud service provider tooling. So you can see it directly within the console of the corresponding cloud service provider, the findings coming out of Prisma Cloud. And then let's at the end of the day, the final level is just bringing together all those different aspects and then use all the capabilities I already briefly touched and we demoed in this advanced demo, and just bring it together, and you can automate all the different things. And you have CLI scripts, you have API scripts. There are different Terraform providers out there to enhance this even further. And then you really have a fully automated end-to-end lifecycle app. But obviously, policy as a code is a very broad topic. So that's why I excluded it from the main presentation. But we are happy to follow up in more detail if you're interested in this a little bit more. Ah, there's a Q&A box. Oh, I see. I haven't seen this Q&A box. Oh, sorry for that. Let me look into the Q&A box. How does it fit with CI the question? Because in the presentation, so what we demoed in, so the screenshot I used in this pipeline stage effectively shows that we just brought in this one. So this is a screenshot from Jenkins, but again, so the same applies to every other pipeline you are using, right? So the flow is effectively that all the different aspects I called out earlier could be easily automated, right? So custom compliance check is a shell or Python script. You have a CLI command. There are out of the box plugins for various CI/CD tools such as CircleCI, Travis or Jenkins and stuff like this. So it's fairly easy to integrate this, but the additional steps I showed here, as a code, it's a very simple script. If you define, okay, it's mandatory that some policy definitions needs to be stored in the Git repository in a particular directory, then it's fairly easy to automate this workflow, that something exists, that the file which exists in there is automatically applied, and then the testing of this thing happens as the final stage. So the primary goal of this demo is really to demonstrate how the different capabilities I explained during these presentations can be used and or leveraged and tested during the pipeline. Has this answered your question, Sharma? Oh, okay. Any other questions? I'm just looking into the other chat. No? Then many thanks again for taking the time. Again, if you have any further questions, just ping us somewhere, and then we are happy to point you to the other assets and also to the existing recordings we have from the pipeline demo. Many thanks.
Okay, so.